had a way of making everyone feel like they're the center. He had that way. When he spoke with you, he spoke to your heart.
BJ thought big. BJ had sufficient talent. He had a regimen of being able to focus, and he was able to inspire people.
Dr. Nordich was a man of passion. He was a man of wisdom. He was one who knew how to get your attention.
Jonathan Nottage was born on October 23, 1945, the second child and second son of Olivia and Bernard Nottage Sr. His brother Kendall, who was 3 years older, recalls his first memories of Bernard.
I admired BJ as a young child because he had nice curly hair. You know, from guys down the street, you know, that was a big thing, got curly hair. Mine was a little naughty. He was a very nice young boy. Yeah, very smart. That's what I remember. He was always clever and smart and was very good at school, you know? He was a scholar, if I must say so. He did very well at school, all levels.
Excellence and integrity are words that have been commonly used to describe BJ Nottage. He developed those qualities within his home at East Street. His father was an inspector in the Royal Bahamas Police Force, the first Bahamian officer to be an expert in the technique of fingerprinting. His mother was industrious.
She had several shops in the East Street area, right down the location where our building is now, on the corner of Life Buoy Street and East Street.
Some years later, his father died unexpectedly. Much later on in life, he told a colleague and friend about the impact his father's death had on him.
At age 10, I think he witnessed his dad dying, and he thought that with better health care, his dad would not have died. And he told me that that was the reason he went into medicine.
After Bernard Sr.'s death, Olivia Nottage became the sole breadwinner and disciplinarian of her five children. A labor of love she handled well. Young Bernard Nottage excelled in school. It came naturally to him. He was also a gifted athlete. His passion for athletics continued throughout his life. Still, with all his talent, BJ Nottage was somewhat of a shy lad. At least that's what Ursula Coakley's first memories of him were.
BJ was a shy person. I've been around BJ from since the Zanzibar days when he used to come there, do shows and sing with his brother Glenn.
When he was a young boy, Atham Abou heard a lot about BJ Nottage. He said he was an inspiration to young men.
Everybody wanted to go around to the house to see this BJ. And when I first saw him, what caught my attention, he was big physically. He had a very lively face. He was engaging and warm person.
After graduation from government high school, and before he went off to study medicine at the University of St. Andrews and the University of Aberdeen in Scotland, Bernard sought work and a bit of adventure on the cruise ship, the Bahama Star. Oswald K. Francis remembers those days.
BJ wanted to work on the ship. I wanted to work on the ship. His daddy and my daddy were friends. So I told my daddy about him. And my dad said, that ain't no problem. I can get you all on the ship. And that's where it started. I went on as a waiter. BJ went on as a bellman.
They later rekindled their friendship as members of the Progressive Liberal Party. Throughout high school, and when he went off to university in Scotland, Dr. Nottage continued to excel, not only academically, but athletically too. He was a sprinter, a 100 meter and 200 meter specialist. He represented the Bahamas in the 1962 Central American and Caribbean Games in Kingston, Jamaica, the 1966 British Empire and Commonwealth Games, also held in Kingston, and the 1967 Pan American Games in Winnipeg, Canada. But the big achievement was making it to the 1968 Olympic Games in Mexico City. He was part of a legendary team that included Norris Stubbs, Kevin Johnson, and Tommy Robinson. They qualified for the semifinals and established a Bahamian national record of 39.45 seconds.
So when you look at Tommy, BJ, Kevin, and Norris Stubbs, it was something. Norris was so good that on the first leg, he was able to beat Charlie Green. And Charlie Green was good. I mean, one of the best sprinters in the United States. And as it would happen, in the quarterfinals, the first round, we did 39.45 seconds. And the hope was up for the semifinals for us to make it to the finals. Now remember, this is the first time we were running the 4x100 meters, any relay in the Olympic Games.
Bernard Nottage finished his athletic career at the 1970 British Commonwealth Games in Edinburgh, Scotland. While in Scotland, BJ Nottage not only competed, but he began to develop skills as a sports administrator too. Those skills came in handy when he became president of the Bahamas Amateur Athletic Association, the B3As. Alpheus Hawk Finlayson says Nottage's contribution to the junior program was outstanding.
Some part of 74, Dr. Nottage came home to the Bahamas, and, well, of course, we have a fraternity. Winston Gus Cooper was the head of the coach for the 68 team in Mexico City. So he sought BJ out and asked BJ to get involved in 1975. So Gus Cooper made BJ the chairman of the organizing committee, and some wonderful things started to happen.
In 1982, he was elected head of the Central American and Caribbean Athletic Confederation. It was during that presidency that he was influential in one of the most significant achievements in the track and field world.
He was the president for 8 years and did some significant things. One of the most significant things was that the question of one country, one vote. And BJ championed that. In Rome, they tried it in 87 in Los Angeles at the Congress, it didn't work. And in 1987 in Rome, they were victorious in that, meaning that the Bahamas has had as much mouth with the vote than any country, any other country, than the Soviet Union, than the United States, the same thing. And that has changed the landscape of track and field in the world.
5 years earlier, Kendall Nottage, who had become the country's first minister of sports in 1977, also benefited from his brother's expertise.
It's BJ who introduced me to the cricketer program and told me all about it with the Caribbean countries and so on. He laid the groundwork, the foundation.
Bernard was close to his family and continued to strengthen his relationship with his brother Kendall and his other siblings. In fact, many believe, though, it was Kendall's influence that propelled him into politics. Although Kendall says Bernard's good friend, Perry Christie, had a lot to do with that. But it was probably a mix of those associations and something instilled in him through family values.
That's from the family, yes. To be of service to people, you know? And BJ was always interested, and so was I, in nation building.
Family time was a happy time for BJ.
He was very comfortable in a family setting. He would laugh, he would, of course, sing, you know. But he was very comfortable. It was never, you never saw him as a boss or someone who persons admired so much. He was just a regular person around his family. And he would joke with them, he would hug them, he would love them. I remember he always used to say, "Barbara, you always hug me from the side. Why do you always hug me from the side?" You know, and then when he became a little ill and I hugged him from the front, he said, "You know, this is the first time she's ever hugged me from the front." You know, so, but he was a lovable person, you know. You couldn't really see it from his exterior, but inside, a heart of gold, man.
I always tell him, "You think you're a singer, you know, but I don't know."
Anyone who knew BJ Nottage knew that he loved to sing and dance. He did a lot of that at his uncle's nightclub, the Zanzibar. Perhaps it was that love for music that enamored him to the beautiful songstress, Portia Butterfield, the woman he took as his wife.
They were always happy together, you know. She would she would always refer to him or defer to him. Dr. Nottage would, he would leave the things with the house and the yard to her. And they had a wonderful time. And then with the kids, they were a real special family.
They had a very close bond and a really loving bond. And that last talk I had with him, I said to him, "Nottage, talk to me of love." And he said, "That's a great thing. Julian, find somebody who you love the way I love Portia."
As an obstetrician and gynecologist, Dr. Nottage helped bring countless Bahamians into the world. Indeed, thousands of babies were born in his hands. Dr. Julian Stewart came to the Bahamas from Jamaica in 1980. His plan was to be a pediatrician and go back to help people in rural parts of Jamaica. That plan, however, changed. He also changed his speciality, in great part due to mentorship under Dr. Nottage.
They'd always come to me to try to get to him. Understanding him was that I naturally was able to communicate with him the right tone, the right manner, and the way you approached him. He was a no-nonsense person, and so you had to be solid when you approach him with what you wanted to do and how you wanted to do it. And
you couldn't be wishy-washy.
You could not be wishy-washy with Dr. Nottage. And he was always thinking, what's the idea behind what you bring to him? I think that was the strength of our relationship over the years.
You can't question God, but he knows best, you know. I didn't even know that Doc was sick.
Dr. Nottage was passionate about representing his constituents. A special few got to know him extremely well. Miss Parole was introduced to him in 1983. She campaigned for him and helped to make him a member of Parliament for the first time in 1987, when he won in the Garden Hills constituency.
Every member in his area, well, I don't care what part it is, and he always say, when you go campaign, don't go regardless of what side they on, you all still talk to them. You don't pick, you just go and make. He was a man, he would greet you like he was never ashamed to hug you or shake your hand.
Rochelle Brown was his constituent in Bain and Grantstown.
My friendship with Dr. Nottage, it growed into me. I was campaigning with Dr. Nottage for 10 years. And as we campaigned, my friendship and the love I had for Dr. Knowledge grew into that. For the things what Dr. Knowledge did for me and my family, I could never forget.
Dr. Knowledge had a positive impact on many lives. To Joy Lee Roll and George Fox, he was like a father.
Every day he used to come by me. Like on Saturdays, he used to say, I said, would you come by me for? So we ain't getting camping, we ain't riding, so we get to, I can talk to you. He said, okay, I'm getting ready. I get ready, we ride. He talked to me. He's like, he showed me like what my father never showed me. Like that father love, he showed it to me.
He came to my mom's funeral, you know, and he came there, he stayed there from the funeral started until the funeral end. He spoke about my mom because he knew her for a long time. And then after that, I saw him again. I was unemployed. I just came from out of a surgery. I was unable to work. And I saw him. And he told me, said, come and see him. And he talked to me, asked me how I'm doing and everything. Me not having a job, it was hard. And he talked, you know, me and my daughter, we talked to him. And he saw that my daughter was able to get the necessary things that she needed in order to go to school. Yeah, and so with that, it's the small things, despite the fact that he knew my mom and knew her political, you know, view or whatever, he never really pushed me aside. So I decided, well, hey, I'll campaign for Knowledge. Everything I did is for Dr. Knowledge.
Kelsey Monroe first met Dr. Knowledge in 2007 when he was a constituent of Bain and Grantstown. Back then, he was on the police force and studying to be an attorney. Monroe says Dr. Knowledge encouraged and inspired him.
Every day was a new day. You couldn't expect the same thing when you work with BJ Knowledge, the wealth of knowledge, the experience that he shared. Brandon Knowledge was a person who spoke frankly, and he would always be honest in any of his answers to you.
He later became an aide and advisor to Knowledge. He describes Dr. Knowledge as an agent of change. He saw Dr. Knowledge's passion to help young men at risk, especially through the program that Dr. Knowledge helped create, Shock Treatment.
Well, parents, I want to thank you all for having the courage to put your children in a program in the hope that that program would help them to develop the potential that God has placed in each of them.
With those three programs, it showed the kind of passion, the kind of zeal that Dr. Knowledge had in trying to transform this country, trying to turn the minds of individuals, in particular young men, from being on the wrong side of the law or running afoul of the law, or even having the thought of creating havoc and showing them, directing them into a direction to be more positive so that they themselves could become role models.
Police Assistant Superintendent Joel Farquharson only met Dr. Bernard Knowledge on May 11, 2012, when Dr. Knowledge was appointed Minister of National Security. Farquharson was made his protection officer and aide. He says, though, that Bernard Knowledge had an impact on him that will last a lifetime.
Exceptional, you know, honest, reliable, trustworthy, no nonsense. I could go on and on and on and on, you know. He always had this mantra about integrity and honesty. That was his mantra in life. Knowing where you want to go, knowing your potentials that God has given you and using your potential to the fullest. He went day by day, always trying to teach somebody something, trying to show somebody something, trying to be an example to somebody. You know, a formidable opponent in every aspect of the world, sporting arena, political arena.
Still, few people knew Bernard Jonathan Knowledge like Barbara Cartwright. They met in 1993. although initially cautious to work with him because of his no-nonsense reputation, she became his right hand in politics, and they were great friends to the end.
I remember I used to draft some speeches for him sometimes, and then when I hear it, I can't recognize hardly anything that I sent him, you know, and I used to be a little hurt about it, you know, but he just did it the way he thought best, you know, and I remember it took me about 7 years to actually write a speech that he actually delivered word for word. And that's when I felt I knew him best, 7 years later. And I think that's when our relationship really took a turn in a different direction, because we became friends as well as working partners. So I saw it and I felt it, and I was in for it in the long haul after that point.
After Sir Lyndon Pinling retired as leader of the Progressive Liberal Party in 1997, Bernard Nottage saw it as his chance to lead. He tried at the 1997 and 1998 PLP conventions, but lost. It was a crushing defeat for him and all those who supported him.
We were very hurt when he lost the leadership against Mr. Christie.
After the loss, Nottage was still eager to make a contribution, but thought perhaps he would make it through another avenue, the Center for Positive Change. But that led to the formation of a new political party, the Coalition for Democratic Reform.
When he became the leader of that political party, he asked me if I would just write for him some stuff on the parliament. And how I think it ought to be, and how it could be used to better the lives of Bahamians, which I did.
That was weeks and months of hard work, late nights. We stood, a group of us got together, and we started the platform.
The CDR had a solid political platform, but still that message did not resonate with voters when they went to the polls in 2002. However, the PLP, which once was home for Bernard Nottage, won the election. The CDR folded, with members including Fenton Niemore and the late Charles Maynard opting to join the FNM. But Bernard Nottage went back home to the PLP.
Doc said, you know, Barbara, no matter how you cut the cookie, my heart is with the PLP. I cannot go back to the FNN or go to the FNN. And so that really wasn't a choice for him, but he wanted the party to explore the options.
In November 2005, Nottage returned to the PLP. Early in 2006, he was appointed to the Senate and served as Minister of Health and National Insurance. He got the nomination for Bain and Grantstown to run in the 2007 general elections. Nottage won the seat, but the PLP lost the election. He had to wait until 2012 for the PLP to be on the winning side.
He came right in this room and he said to me, he said, Barbara, this is going to be the first time in a long time that, the PLP has won. We're going to be in government for 5 full years. He said, most of my time has been spent in opposition. And if you look back in 1992, when he won a seat, he was in opposition. 1997, opposition. 2007, he won the seat, but again, his party was not in power. And he said, this time, Barbara, I'm going to make it count. This is where I'm going to leave my legacy. So, it's hard.
Dr. Nottage served as leader of opposition business in the House of Assembly for the 2007 and 2012 parliamentary terms.
So this is pervasive, Mr. Speaker. And let's look at it. The home, the school, and the church are the three institutions that are supposed to form our children, that are supposed to instill in them the values, that is supposed to monitor them, and that is supposed to discipline them. And if in the home they're being abused, then God help the society that they inherit.
Former Chief Clerk of the House of Assembly, Maurice Tynes, speaks to Bernard Nottage's parliamentary contributions over the years.
During their tenure, you know, we improved, we updated the laws, the rules of the House for the first time since about 1964. The rules had not been upgraded since 1964. And in around 2005, the new rules were introduced into the House.
Former Prime Minister Perry Christie was a lifelong friend of Dr. Bernard Nottage. They shared a love for athletics and politics. Keishla Adderley spoke to Mr. Christie shortly after Dr. Nottage's death.
Dr. Bernard Nottage has walked these streets more than 100 times. Bain and Grantstown, bordered by Nassau Street, East Street, and Wolf Road, have been his campaign stomping ground for the last 10 years. But his love for politics, his tenure, and his inclination date back much longer than that. We sat down to talk to former Prime Minister, the Right Honorable Perry Christie, about his colleague, sometimes competitor, and friend, about the brotherhood bound by politics, sports, and a mutual love and respect, and about the day that that friendship became but a memory.
Whether as comrades or competitors, the late Dr. Bernard Nottage and former Prime Minister, the Right Honorable Perry Christie, have stood side by side for the last 60 years, a brotherhood bound by sports, politics, and genuine admiration and respect.
We had this very close relationship, and then when BJ came home from school, I was the intending member of parliament. I was running. I invited him to coordinate my campaign. He coordinated my campaign in 1977. He coordinated my campaign in 1982 for the Centerville constituency. Then he ran in 87. He consulted me and his brother Kendall about whether he should accept Sir Lyndon's, well, then Lyndon Pinling's, was interested in running him in 82. And I said, listen, man, your mama had you become a gynecologist and obstetrician. Go make your money and then come into politics. And that was the general advice. So he came in, I think, in 87 at Garden Hills. And thereafter, he went into Kennedy and became a defining member of parliament in Kennedy. He became really associated with that area in a very meaningful way. He accepted ministerial responsibilities under Pinling, both, I think, in consumer affairs and education. And whatever he did, he brought an incredible sense of discipline to the job. BJ has excelled in politics, he has excelled in medicine, and he has excelled in what I would call business. And he developed St. Luke's, for example, both the laboratory and the clinic itself as an owner, all right? And he just excelled in sports. And let me just very briefly indicate what I mean. When he came home, he led a delegation of qualified specialists to meet Lyndon Pinling to complain that they were not being made consultants, which would give them the right for private practice. They were senior registrars. It was like a year before the general elections of 77. We are talking about people like Ronnie Knowles, Mac Campbell of Ear, Nose and Throat, Dr. David Sands, Dr. Perry Gomez. All of these young doctors went to see Pinling. Pinling says, hold on. I ran in 1997 and I won. So Lyndon then telephoned me and asked me to see him and said, I'm making you the Minister of Health. You know all these young men who came to see me? It was in 1977. And he said, do you know these young men who came to see me? I said, yes. He says, well, you know what to do. I made them all consultants. Dr. Nottage became a major contributor to my well-being as a Minister of Health. He was the forerunner of family planning. I mean, he got involved in medical issues well beyond the time when the country was. I remember the controversy surrounding some of his pronouncements on birth control and elements to do with gynecology and obstetrics. He became president of the Medical Association. He became president of the Doctors' Union. As a consultant, he was mentoring lots of people. I heard Dr. Sands, the current Minister of Health, Ernie Sands, speak glowingly of him and how he was so instructive to them. And so he did well with medicine, and he became someone who delivered all three of my children. And he, in fact, when I walked upstairs yesterday and met my wife, just very, very tearful and sorrowful, and she had just found out that BJ had died, I think it's indicative of how women who he attended as a doctor will respond and react to his death, because he was that kind of doctor, where he really reached into the family and treated the patient holistically.
The former Prime Minister remembers a politician who was thoughtful, ambitious, and whose generosity had no end, often being extended to his constituents in Bain and Grantstown. He says it was perhaps the combination of that love and stubborn spirit which was reflected in his determination to, notwithstanding his illness, continue in the career he lived and breathed.
I think when I look back at it and I ask the question, whether he ought to have run, whether he ought to have subjected himself to the pressure and stress of competing in an election and going house to house. And I realized it was BJ that, you know, this old saying, cowboy want to die with their boots on. It was just Dr. Nottage. And because he was a favorite person of mine, who never ever allowed his name to be caught up in any compromised issue. And then when you look back at his career, you will find without fear of contradiction that he was never involved in anything near scandalous. Always sort of impeccable in his conduct and impeccable in his behavior. He had a tremendous love and passion for the country, and he showed it in so many different ways.
Mr. Christie said his final conversation with Dr. Nottage at his hospital bedside was hard. The two spoke about their life and times, their accomplishments, and the abstract issues of life. Dr. Nottage's answer to the question about his will to live all led back to the journey he began 40 years ago.
I asked him if he had the will to live. And he looked at me. He says, you know I have the will to live. So you know that. He says, my difficulty right now is I might be without insurance. And that's what my concern is. Am I without, because we were caught between being insured as a minister and then being uninsured as a... And so he had that dilemma. I said, man, that shouldn't be your concern. The last thing in the world you should be thinking about is that. He says, no, Christy, he said, you know, I'm just thinking about life. I'm thinking about what's going to happen. He said, and you know what, it's a pity for me that I'm the first one. I said, what do you mean you're the first one? The first one of our lot. And he just left it like that. It's the first one to be sick, the first one to be hospitalized, the first one to be challenged, the first one to die. The final experience I had with him was that they called me to tell me he was being admitted to hospital. And I went up there. And he was hooked up to equipment, but not, he can talk, not his mouth. And I chose to speak to him about our life together. I asked him if he was aware of the extent of his illness and how sick he really was. And he said, yes. I said, really challenged? Said, yes. I said to him how we've been together for so long. And then I came to the point where I said, BJ, we lost together. I said, out of our defeat will come opportunities. It is for us to determine what those opportunities are. But we have to first accept that the curtain has come down and that maybe historians one day will examine in its fullness our contribution and make a determination on how it should be measured and how it should be seen in the context of our times. And I remember, Keisha, I remember saying to him, BJ, I'm going to leave you now. And I remember rubbing his hair. I said, you know, this is a big fight for you. And you must ensure that you fight with all your might, because it will help. Shortly after that, he slipped into a coma. So I will sit here at night and think of my friend who is no more, and ask myself the question as to life. And I repeat it over and over, you know. As for a man, his days are as grass. As a flower in the field, he flourisheth. For the wind passes over, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more.
Dr. Nottage first entered these halls of Parliament back in 1982. On April 27, 2017, he ended the electoral term. But little did any of us know it would be his last time in Parliament.
Dr. Nottage had to be hospitalized on June 20th. He was subsequently airlifted to Florida, where he died on June 28th. We often wonder what impact we will leave after we are gone. What our legacy might be.
BJ has touched so many things, whether it's family care, the care for mothers, for women, inspiring young men to be men, considering young youngsters who've lost their way to have a second chance. He believed you can do it. And his favorite place was East Street. He always believed that anybody from East Street can overcome any hurdle and arise and rise to their level. So I believe that he can be a inspiration for the nation, and I believe our country needs that.
I want them to remember of a man of integrity, man who had class, man who know how to speak to people, a man who was in, like, to pick this one and pick the next one.
What I will remember most of him, his action with people, and his memory will go down as one of our best doctors.
Ursula Coakley believes his response in the community after Hurricane Matthew in 2016 will be appreciated for years to come.
I could imagine him when after the hurricane, he comes stepping up in his water boots, because we had a lot of damage to the roof, because he was hands-on with that, with everybody. And I can afford to say that, because you will pass him and he'll be out there on the road. Okay? So it's a lot that you'll remember BJ Bernard Jonathan Nottage about.
For his brother Kendall, it was the spiritual acknowledgement that was most important.
The last time I spent with him together was New Year's Day. New Year's Eve night, 2016, New Year's Day 2017.
I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet.
His passing was a big blow to me, you know? But I give Almighty God thanks for having him as a brother and for God blessing him in the way he did.
However, there was no doubting his love for the Bahamas and the Bahamian people.
He always wanted a different and better way for Bahamians. And when he came back, for instance, he observed the number of teenage pregnancies increasing in the Grahamstown, Bain and Grahamstown area. And I think, if my memory serves right, that he started Planned Parenthood Association. And he got much flack for that because a lot of the ministers, religious leaders, were not for that. They didn't like it. But he was always deeply concerned about what was happening with Bahamians.
His greatest legacy to me is excellence. He was a man of excellence. He was a perfectionist. He challenged you to greater levels. I have learned so much from Doc. You know, a lot of people would say, you gave so much to him, but I can safely say he gave a lot to me.
I just hope that the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas realize the giant of a man that we have lost, you know. God knows all things, and he knows what's best. But we lost a patriot. We lost a giant.